Alright, what's up guys? Welcome back to Asgard, and welcome to a second episode of our Applied Energistics Tips and Tricks series. I know there was some confusion last episode, so I want to go ahead and start off with something that we touched on last episode with the P2P tunnels. Basically, when you're using them, let's say we've got a dense line running out here. So this has 32 channels coming off of this controller face. And then we hook our P2P tunnel right here, and we bring out our Fluix cable, and then it connects into our dense line. And so then we'll set up our controller here, bring our dense line over, just like we set up last episode, have our smart cable, and then say our P2P, and then that hooks into our dense cable. So the way this works is this is bringing... Once we link this up, shift right click and then left click. So this is bringing these 32 channels just over to here is what it's doing. So I can do say 8 here, 8 here, 8 here, and 8 here, or you know, any combination. I could have 4, 3, 1, 7, 6 or something, you know. But basically 8 max channels on these smart cables and 32 total on this line. This is basically, you have to think of this line as this line. So, of course we don't have the power hooked up. Let me do that really quick. And I know somebody mentioned on Reddit that I only need to use one quartz fiber. I know, I have this weird tendency when I use ME, for some reason I make everything even. So I'll use quartz fibers on each of them. It's just a weird habit of mine, so sorry if that bothered anybody. But anyway, so we've got power running through here and power running through there. So you just have to think of those 32 channels as these 32 channels. But the reason that we do this is because with this setup, we could say, I don't want to use different colors. If I used a different color, I could set it here, or if I use cable anchors. But we could say set up another P2P tunnel here. Well, let me actually do different colors because that might get kind of confusing. Say lime and lime. Okay. So we could have, say, a lime channel running out here and have that connected right here. And then have ourselves, say, a lime channel that comes out right here. And like that. And our memory card, we'll shift right click to clear the settings and then grab those settings and hook this up. Oops, I shift right clicked. Okay, save that and hook it up right here. So now we have, oops, we have another line coming out there. Oh, shoot. I don't feel like putting down cable anchors, so we'll just set it up right there. So the reason that we do this is so that we can transfer up to 32 of these P2P lines. So we could have, say, 8 connected on this. So we could have, say, another like another P2P here and one here and so on. And have 8 on this line and then do like another segment here of 8 and another of 8, another of 8, basically to fill this up to 32 channels, 32 P2P tunnels that would be connected on this one dense cable. And then, since it hits this controller and changes to a different face, that gives us an additional 32 channels this way. So we would have 32 P2Ps here, 32 P2Ps here, and have a total of 1,024 channels running through this dense cable line. And then we could always use another face here and so on, and we could add onto this controller and basically maximize the amount of channels that we can run and only have to use one cable to run them. So I hope that makes sense. I know there was some confusion. It's not a matter of bonus channels. It's just basically transferring these 32 channels over to, you know, a separate area, but able to transfer 32 sets of 32 on one line. So I hope that kind of clarifies it a little bit. And if not, just let me know. But anyway, this episode, I had a request to talk a little bit about some crafting tips and tricks with applied energistics and auto crafting and everything. So that's what we're going to be covering this episode. So first thing that I want to talk about is when you set up your crafting, of course, you're going to use your crafting storage. That's what's going to allow you to store or to actually use the auto crafting method. So if you don't have some, you know, if you don't have enough bytes of crafting storage, you're not going to be able to craft something. And you know, initially using just a 16K would be fine. Maybe a 16K, maybe even throw a crafting co-processing unit or two on there. That would be perfectly fine. But as you progress, the design that I tend to like to use personally is a lot of times I'll do something like this, and then I'll do a 64Ks here, or you can do 16Ks. The reason I do 64Ks, honestly, is because of the fact that a lot of times, especially if you have AE2 stuff in the pack, which I'm actually, yeah, it does. Or not AE2 stuff, extra sales, sorry. You'll notice that there's some storage components that are massive in here that take, that take a long list of crafting recipes. You have to use 4096s and 1024s and 256s and 64s. It's when you start crafting a lot more advanced things like that that you're going to need larger crafting units, crafting multi-blocks here. So, you know, initially I would just suggest doing like a 16K and a few of the crafting co-processing units. But as you advance, you know, you'll want to add on to these. But ideally, you'll want to build, it's more really about quantity, I think, especially early on, than it is about the quality initially. So we'll do a couple like this, maybe add some more crafting co-processing units. These are actually very important to a good crafting unit, because for each of these crafting co-processing units, your crafting system is able to do more of the processes involved with crafting something. So for example, if you didn't have any crafting co-processing units and you wanted to take, say, a piece of wood and then craft it into planks, craft those planks into sticks, and craft those sticks into, say, torches. If you didn't have any crafting co-processing units, if you only had, say, a 16K crafting storage, that would be enough to craft all of that, I mean, as far as the bytes used. But what would happen was it would only be able to really use like one molecular assembler at a time, and it would craft, say, all the wood into planks, and then it would craft all the planks into sticks, and all the sticks into torches. So you're going to have more of a waiting time. Now granted, with that with that example, you're not going to really have that much of a wait time. It's a pretty simple crafting recipe. But when you start getting into the more advanced stuff, you really want these crafting co-processing units, because they're going to speed up things a lot. And you're also going to want a decent amount of the storage, because everything that's crafted has a specific amount of bytes used that it needs to craft things. So if you kind of skimp on the crafting a lot, you're not going to be able to do mass orders of large amounts of things. So especially with like Sky Factory and stuff, there's been times I order like 1,000 of something to go out and build. And so stuff like that is going to take a lot of storage, depending on what you're making and everything. So I do suggest doing at least a decent amount of crafting storage. I tend to go with at least maybe 2 64Ks, or say a few 16Ks. It just depends on where I'm at and kind of what I'm estimating to be crafting and how big of a scale, you know. And then as far as the way to set up your molecular assemblers with your interfaces, I know everybody has their own personal preferences. If I can find, there we go. I know everybody has their own personal preferences. I know a lot of people tend to set up, a lot of people that I've watched in like Let's Plays and stuff tend to set up, like, especially early on, they'll set up interface and do like interfaces connected to a single molecular assembler. Now, the way I tend to do it personally, the way I've always enjoyed doing it, is I will set up a line of, say, 8 interfaces here. And what I would do is I would run molecular assemblers up this. And initially, I just do 3 until I get, say, all my patterns in here. And if I want to put, like, a card or something in there, I would do that. And then I would generally put like acceleration cards into the molecular assembler once I had the power and everything to make that a reasonable, you know, setup and whatnot. So that's generally how I'll set it up, but it's really just your preference. Would you can either have more patterns per molecular assembler, or you can have more molecular assemblers per pattern. But like I said, I tend to have more molecular assemblers just because it tends to make things faster, and it can disperse, say, like this interface, for example. If I had 4 molecular assemblers around this one interface, and I had crafting co-processing units, at least, say, 3 of them, it would be able to use all 4 of these molecular assemblers to, say, craft 64K storage cells. It would be able to use all 4 of these at the same time to be crafting. So it would actually speed things up by quite a bit when it comes to that, when it comes to ordering large scale amounts of things. So, but it really just depends on your preference as far as that goes, you know, how you want to set that up. Next up, I hope that answers any questions about like CPU optimization and stuff. I tend to have a lot of these, generally at least 1 dense cable line. I'll end up doing, like long-term wise, I'll try to get 32 of these built, because say I ordered torches, for example. Let's pretend that torches took a long time to craft, or 64K storage cells. Those took a long time to craft. And so I ordered those, and I only had 1 CPU set up. I didn't have these other 2. And then I went to order, say, some tesseracts. It's not I'm not even going to be able to request those tesseracts until it finishes crafting the 64Ks, since I've only got the 1 CPU. But if I had, say, 2 CPUs, I could have one of these would be focused on building our storage cells, one of them would be crafting our tesseracts, and so on. So later on, you know, as my AE systems tend to progress, I tend to like to have stuff automated so that it keeps so much of a thing in a system. Like I showed you last episode, where you set up the interface and the storage bus, I tend to keep so many processors and so many storage cells and so many of all these different things that I generally have a lot of CPUs that are always active doing something, you know, especially once it crafts a storage cell or it, you know, does different things like that. It has to go through and it has to make all these things for me. So I always like to have CPUs free so that if I want to craft something, I have the ability to do that. So anyway, I hope that answers any questions about CPU optimization. The next thing that I want to talk about is how to automate the basic applied energistics machines, because I know a lot of people have had issues with that. Now, I will say, if you have AE2 stuff in your pack, I suggest you just use this route, because you can get these crystal growth chambers and these advanced inscribers. They are wonderful, and I definitely suggest using them if you have them in the pack, because these, you know, as long as they have power ran to them, there we go. So they've got power now, and if you notice, it says they're sleeping. They're not going to use any power while they're sleeping, and you can automate these just with an interface connected to them. And the inscriber, you can set these and automate them so much easier than the standard AE2 inscribers. But these are pretty straightforward as far as automation, because for the crystal growth chamber, let's say we've got some seeds. Let me find them here. So we've got some, say, Fluix seeds, nether quartz seeds, Certus seeds, all this stuff. This can just hold all of that at once, and if you notice, it's going to work through that stuff. And you can also put acceleration cards in here to make it very, very fast. Even without acceleration cards in here, it's still pretty fast, honestly. And they're really not that expensive to craft once you start getting into applied energistics. The same with the Inscriber, not that bad. So if you do have AE2 stuff in the pack, go ahead and use that because it will make your life a lot easier. However, if you don't, I know a lot of packs don't have it and whatnot. And especially if you're playing on a server, you're not going to be able to add that. So what we're going to do is we're going to cover how to automate those if they're not in your pack. So what we'll do, we'll start with the, I guess we'll start with the charger. It's fairly straightforward to automate. Let me find it here. There we go. So let's just bring, let's actually break this stuff. And we'll just bring this out to say, no, actually I don't want that there at all. Let's bring this out. I know I'm using a lot of the same colors and stuff, but that's okay. And we'll set up our interface here. And let's grab some empty patterns. And we'll put them into our pattern terminal here. Okay, so for example, we want to teach our charger to make charge Certus quartz for us. So all we'd have to do is we'd have to, oh, let me grab the charge Certus. And I tell you what, let me grab a ME drive as well and throw some storage things in there because we don't actually have any storage set up at the moment. There we go. Sounds good. And we'll set this up just right over here. Alright, beautiful. Okay, so now that we've got that set up, in the pattern terminal, of course, you hit processing to change over to something. Unless it's standard crafting, you're going to use processing. And we're going to tell it, if you take one Certus and send it to where I'm telling you to send it, you're going to get a charge Certus back. So we'll encode that, and we'll just put this recipe into the interface right here, and we'll set a chest here with the interface, and you really don't have to do this, but I always tend to do it just because I like everything to look nice, and I like the way it's laid out personally. I kind of sometimes have like an OCD about it, I think. Yeah, sometimes. There we go. So we're going to tell this that it's going to dump its items here. And we're going to put our pattern in here for our charge Certus quartz. And then what we're going to do is we're just going to set up an item conduit, say here, and we're going to say you're going to extract always active, and you're going to import into this line right here. And you're also going to extract on the brown line, always active, put a filter in here and say you're going to take charge, or you're going to pull out charge Certus quartz. And pull that, push this into here. Okay. And then let's give it some power. So let's bring this on over to here. And which this isn't pretty. You know, you can make it a lot better looking. This is just for showing you guys how I lay this out anyway. And we'll bring our pipes over to here, and we're going to tell it to insert on the brown channel. So now what we should see is if we were to come over here and say order, let's order 20 of these. You should see them, see how they're going into the charger, and the conduits will be pulling them out once they finish. So it does take it a second usually, but we'll give it just a moment here. There we go. See, we got one. And so that way we can just get our charge service, and we can also set up our system to automatically keep so much charge service on hand. You know, so we've always got it, but we can also teach our system to make it so that it can request it if it needs the charge service for something that we're crafting. So like I said, you can make this a lot prettier, but you do need to use the chest, in my experience, or some kind of an inventory, because these interfaces won't connect straight into the pipes very well, or at least the Ender IO conduits. There may be some pipes that it will connect to, but this is just generally the pipe that I use because I can facade it and I can make it look nice, and kind of out of sight, out of mind kind of a thing. The next thing that I want to cover is the inscriber. Now the inscriber, there is a way that you can set it up with Steve's Factory Manager, and I've done it a few times in the past, but honestly, why do I have so much molecular assemblers? Okay. But honestly, the way that I tend to make it, and I'll show you that. If you guys want like a Steve's Factory video or something like that, I'd be more than happy to do one. But I'm going to show you the way that I generally set it up because I tend to like it this way. Plus, when you're making larger storage cells, it is quite a bit quicker because you've got separate lines for each of them. So we'll just bring a line. No, let me actually break that. I know we've got a huge mess of cables on our hands. The way I tend to do it is I will just say, I'll set up an inscriber, and we're just going to put it right here, for example. And we'll set up an interface and a chest, just like we did last time. Because you can pretty much automate every machine in the game as long as you use this system. Because not everything can just be pushed by an interface into the machine and it just works. But if you use the chest and you use smart pipe placement and machine setup and everything, you can automate pretty much everything that way. So one thing to note about the inscriber is the sides actually do different things with conduits. So if we insert from the top, that's going to insert this top slot. So we'll tell this to insert. If you insert from the bottom, it's going to insert this bottom slot. And if you insert from the side here, it is going to insert on the side slot. And then your extract would be the front side here. So we're always going to extract our finished products out the front and just bring them up and over. And like I said, you can make this a lot prettier, but we are just going for showing you guys how this works. And we'll just set that to insert. No need to filter that or anything. Now what we will do is we will filter this. So for example, this inscriber, it kind of depends on what you're wanting to make. I tend to set up multiple inscribers. So I'll have one for each of the presses, and then I'll have one for finished products. So let's say, for example, we wanted to make, in this particular inscriber, we want to make, let's do one with the press. If I can find the presses. Here we go, calculation press. So let's grab some of those, and let me find a calculation is what, diamond, correct? I believe. Sardis, sorry, my bad. So what we would do is we would say you can insert, and for this one we wouldn't have to use the bottom line. You really only need that for the finished product. But we would just put a filter in here, and we would say you can accept, let me grab some Sardis. I'll use pure, I guess. It really doesn't matter. And we'll throw some in here just for when we set it up. So we would tell it, you will accept pure Sardis. And then this top one, we also wouldn't have to use that, because what we can do is we can just set our calculation press in there, and it's not going to go anywhere. So then all we'd have to do is hook our cables up, like so. And we're going to say extract always active there. And then if we taught our system that if it takes and sends one pure Sardis, that it is going to get oh, let me find it. Calculation processor, there we go. Okay. That it's going to get one calculation processor. And we encode that, and we throw that recipe into this interface. Now we can go ahead and request a calculation processing or processor. And if we give it, well, actually we can come over here and, oh, no power. Duh. And let's just grab some Fluix cable, because I just threw the blue away. So there we go. We'll give it some power, and you'll notice it's running, and it should pump right back into the system here. And there we go. We got ourselves a printed calculation circuit. Wait. Okay. Why did I tell it to make a calculation processor? My mistake. But anyway, that's how you would set that up. I apologize. I'm losing my mind, I think. And we can just set this in here, by the way, change this recipe, and re-encode, and it's going to change it for us. Just in case you didn't know, you can change those recipes anytime. So, however, if you wanted to set this up for the finished products, you would say the top would accept your three different processors. So we'll grab these really quick, and we would say it would accept our printed calculation circuits, our printed engineering circuits, or our printed logic circuits. So we'll put these three in there, and then the bottom we're going to tell it can accept our printed silicon, and then the side here will accept our redstone. And then if we just link up these item conduits, now if we teach the system to that if it takes a printed calculation circuit, a piece of redstone, and a printed silicon circuit, that it's going to get a calculation processor, and we encode that. Now we can throw that in there. We can order a calculation processor, and you should see that all the items, oh, I forgot to pull that out. That's why you kind of want to do four different ones. I personally do. And it's going to craft that for you. So, like I said, you can do it with just one inscriber with Steve's Factory Manager. But honestly, it does make your life a lot easier to just use four of them. But if you guys want to see that set up, I'd be more than happy to do it. And the last thing I want to show you this episode is the crystal growth automation. So if you don't have the AE2 stuff, crystal growth automation, it's a little bit more involved than a lot of other automations, because it happens in the real world instead of in a machine or something like that. It actually has to be placed in the world and picked up and everything. So the way that I tend to do it, let's go ahead and set up over here, because we've got these lines over here. This will be fine. So we'll have our crystal growth accelerators set up just like that, and then we'll just run our cabling up and over here. Oops. Okay. And you can leave these running. They really don't draw that much power, but I tend to automate shutting them off. So that's what I'm going to show you guys, is how to automate shutting them off and also getting your items out. Let's go ahead and dig down here. We'll put a crystal growth accelerator up there for now. Or any block, sorry. It doesn't have to be a crystal growth accelerator. And we're just going to put a transfer node for items right there. And then what we'll do is we will... let me grab some transfer pipes. Okay. And we'll just bring this out. Like that. And what we'll do is we'll set a filter. Let me grab the stuff that we're going to want. So we're going to tell it pure Certus, Fluix Crystals, pure Fluix Crystals, and then pure Nether Quartz. So that's the four different things that you can make in the water and with the Crystal Growth Accelerators. Of course, the Fluix Crystal, you could set it up to not even be on this system because it doesn't actually need the Growth Accelerators because it's instantaneous, but you might as well just put it with this. It just saves you space. But what we can do here is we can set our four crystals to that and put that filter into here, and then we'll put a world interaction upgrade because that's going to allow it to interface with this actual open area and remove items that are you know, in there that fit the filter. And we'll put our water in there. So we've got that set up. Now, as far as dropping and automatic shutoff, that's a little bit more involved. So let's empty out all this junk here to give us some space. Now, the way I tend to do it is with an ME toggle bus. And let's see, level emitters. And then we're going to set up... just an interface. Let's see, where do we want to set that up at? Let's think. We're actually going to break this line here. We're going to set up our interface right there, and let's say you're actually going to push up, and we're going to put a chest right there, so that any items that it requests are going to get put into that chest. And we'll bring our transfer pipes up and over. So any finished products are going to go straight back into that interface. So all that's linked up. Now, the way we're going to toggle the power on and off is, let's bring... No, let's not bring it right there. Let's bring it out just a little bit here. We'll put our toggle bus right there and then say link up the power here. And like I said, you can do this a lot prettier, but now these should be getting power when this has a redstone signal. But since it doesn't, let's set up our toggle or our level emitters here. Actually, we might... Yeah, we'll do that. And let's run a separate colored line, just so it doesn't connect, because we can connect that into the interface. It's not going to hurt anything. And we'll bring this over like this. And we'll put our level emitters right here. And if you notice, they're all emitting a redstone signal now, so this is getting power. But what we're going to do is we're going to set up... Whoops. We're going to set these up with crafting cards. So let me find them here. And what we can do is we can tell it that... we're only going to emit a redstone while an item is crafting. And we're going to do that for all three of these. Item is crafting. And while item is crafting. So now we're not getting any power because we're not crafting anything. But we can specify with this, we can say that, let me grab those again, pure Certus, oops, yeah, pure Certus, pure Fluix, and pure Nether Quartz. So we can set these up and say, you're going to turn on when we're crafting pure Nether Quartz. You're going to turn on when we're crafting pure Fluix, and you are going to turn on when we're crafting pure Certus. So we're not going to be getting any power to this. And then as far as how we get the items in there, I tend to just use any kind of a dropper. I like the one from Batania, personally, the open crate. So let me grab it here. Tell you what, I just pulled it this way. I tend to always... do it like search just the mod instead of the actual item. I don't know why that is, but it's another strange habit of mine. Alright, so we'll bring this over. We'll set this to extract always active. We'll bring this to right there. Actually, right there is fine. And okay, the bottom is in the right spot. We'll set this to insert. And then we'll set up our patterns just really, really quickly. So we'll tell it, if it takes one Certus Quartz seed, then it is going to get a pure Certus Quartz. And we'll encode that. And I'm not going to set up all the patterns. You guys, I'm sure you know how to set up patterns for the other two of these. So we've got that pattern in there. So we'll go tell it now. We're going to say we want to get rid of all this junk. 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 Okay. So we're going to tell it we want... How many of those did I put in there? Did I put any of those in there? No. Okay. Which the Certus Quartz seeds, I'm sure you guys know how to make that, so I'm not going to worry about that. We're going to say we want 64. We want 64 pure Certus. We'll tell it to start, and you'll see the Certus is dropping in there, and it's not going anywhere. And if you notice, that redstone, that level emitter, just kicked on because we are crafting pure Certus Quartz. And what it does, it allows that toggle bus. These toggle buses... the standard toggle buses will only transfer power when it's getting a redstone signal. Oh, excuse me. And then the inverted toggle buses will only, they will give power unless they're receiving a redstone signal. So, you can kind of set it up either way. I just tend to go with the straight up toggle bus. And so now this is growing down there. And we'll give it just a second and I'll be back once they start finishing. Okay, welcome back. They're starting to finish now, if you notice. And if we fly over here and they're not done yet, are they? Thought they were done. They should be right about done. By the way, you can, like I said, you can set this up with anything. If you want to go Applied Energistics Purist with this design, you can use a formation plane here instead of the open crate. but I just tend to do the open crate. I like the way it drops, and I've always just liked the block. Plus, it's fairly cheap and easy to set up and all. They should start pulling out any minute. There we go. So we got 9 and 18. So it's, see, the transfer node is picking them up as soon as they finish up. And you could put speed upgrades into that, or more world interaction upgrades, or whatever, and it would speed that up. And also keep in mind that if you wanted to put this transfer node farther down, you can actually do that, because if you add additional world interaction upgrades past the first one, it'll allow you to pick up blocks a little bit higher. or items a little bit higher. So, you know, if you wanted, I don't know, if you wanted to put a block down there that, say, detects when an item's touching it, not really a pressure plate, but something else, you could do that and then put the transfer node one block lower. So that's an option as well, but you would have to use, you know, the two world interaction upgrades. But anyway, I hope this video has been helpful for you. I hope it wasn't too long. I'm not entirely sure the length myself right this second, but I hope you guys learned something from it, and I hope it helped you out. As always, if you do have any questions, feel free to let me know. I hope I explained everything in detail, and I hope it helps you guys. So, you know, I did this because I had a comment on the last video, and someone was requesting to see some crafting tips. So, you know, if you guys have any requests, feel free to let me know, and I will do my best to get to them as soon as possible. So, you know, just feel free to let me know, and if you have any questions, definitely hit me up. Social networking stuff is listed down below, and so feel free to hit me up on there or just here on YouTube. So if you enjoyed the video, as always, please comment, like, subscribe. It's very, very much appreciated. And until next episode, do take care, and I hope to see you then.